Welcome to Indie Corner. We talk about all things independent comics. I'm Mikey.
I'm Rebecca.
And today, people, we're back at it again with an episode of the Indie Corner podcast. And today, people, it's a little special one because I don't know if people have been checking their calendars, have been checking their Google logos are changing. But apparently, it is Women's History Month. And so we want to do something for Women's History Month. And so today we wanted to do a book, which Rebecca, I don't know about you, but we kind of like immediately kind of figured which book to do for Women's History Month because we've talked about this book for a while.
Yeah.
But
I was going to say, I read the first issue of this a while ago and then I never got around to reading any issue after that. So I was excited to jump back into this.
Yep. And as the title, as you can tell from the title, we're going to be covering the critically acclaimed book, Bitch Planet by Kelly Sue DeConnick with art by Valentine DeLandro from Image Comics. And I'm excited because I've always heard about this book for as long as I've been into indie comics. I've always heard about how good this book is. I mean, Kelly Sue DeConnick's kind of well known for, you know, her run on Captain Marvel and especially her indie work, especially because she is very, very unapologetic, unlike of the commentary she wants to tell in her stories. So Bitch Planet was something that, you know, was pretty pretty well known. I was about to say infamous, but not really infamous, but mostly like famous in a way. But it's very.
I think you hit the nail on the head when you said it was unapologetic, because that's how I kind of would call it. That, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. It's pretty much like, you know, like a fuck you, pay me type book. I like it. I'm excited. Rebecca, you're excited.
I'm excited. Happy We're Women's doing History a Month. Women's History Month book in Women's History Month. So that's right? More I can say than what listen. We did last month.
Oh shit! Yeah. But listen, it was a funny joke because like when we started the late Black History Month special, I just said that this freaking. I said that the podcast ran on CPT, so that's why I was like, it's valid, you know? but people, I'm excited. Rebecca, you're excited. And without further ado, we're going to be starting off with Bitch Planet. So, Rebecca, you have issue number one?
Yep. All right. So if we want to just jump right into this again, Bitch Planet by Kelly Sue DeConnick. So we open up where a woman is running through a futuristic city with some clearly dystopian billboards surrounding her. Her coworker counts down from 10 as she just barely makes it to the recording studio to read the following lines. Space is the mother who receives us, Earth is the father, and your father has cast you out. And as she says this, we see a spaceship leaving Earth's atmosphere, and inside a group of female criminals, we're talking radicals, killers, and one volunteer, headed to serve a sentence on Bitch Planet.
We are on Bitch Planet.
Yeah, that's where you put like the big title graphic there in the movie.
Yeah, I only have it once. I only have it one time, but yeah, I do have it.
Yeah, they do that every issue, which is kind of cool. They kind of work it in like how Invincible does in the show.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, yes.
It's very title cardy.
Like, just for people that don't know, like with when Kelly Sue DeConnick and Valentine DeLandro were coming up with the idea for this book has a very big like exploitation like film genre or like grindhouse film genre influence to it. So that huge ass like title page in a film, that's pretty much what it's supposed to homage. So I like that a lot. I think it works very well.
Yeah, and we'll talk about this later, but you see this in the covers too, the same kind of style mm-hmm. and feel.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, upon landing on the aforementioned Bitch Planet, the prisoners are greeted by a holographic woman and told to grab their uniforms. One of these prisoners, Penelope, who's a big girl, tells the guard in so many words that she's not going to fit in her uniform. But as she talks back, another guard starts to beat her up. Another prisoner stands up for her, and as the guard's distracted, Penelope uppercuts them again asking, "Where am I supposed to put my tits?" and starts inciting a riot. As the riot breaks out, one woman proclaims she doesn't belong here and doesn't deserve this before she's knocked out by a guard. Back on Earth, we see a man demanding to speak to someone in charge about his wife. The manager explains his wife was detained for compliance issues and that this can't be a mistake as they have safeguards against this sort of thing. The husband insists that the safeguards failed. They're realizing we have a turn here. But he's upset because you don't ever hear about people coming back from Bitch Planet or the Auxiliary Compliance Outpost, as the government likes to call it. Back at the prison, the woman we saw get knocked out is awake, and the hologram woman in the form of a sexy nun prompts her to confess her sins. We learn this woman's name is... It's really hard to describe this book without the visuals, because the visuals are really carrying it in a lot of places.
Yeah, I had to. There's no way we could just talk about the book without showing what's actually happening in it.
Yeah, for sure. So we learned this white woman's name is Marion Collins, and she follows the hologram as the other prisoners count the guards, even though they're on a remote planet, so it's escape is pretty much impossible for them. So in this next part, we intercut between parallel conversations between Marion and the hologram and the husband on Earth. Marion says she loves her husband, and he says he loves his wife. The husband admits to having affairs, and Marion says that she drove him to it. As he talks, Mr. Collins reveals that he had originally paid a fee to have his wife taken away, even though it was basically her first defense. Marion says she's changed and forgave her husband, and Mr. Collins claims that just like that, they moved on from the incident. The manager on Earth claims fixing these things take time, and Mr. Collins slides him an envelope. Meanwhile, Marion is led to a cell/torture device thing, with the hologram telling her that pain will be her salvation. Like before, the other prisoners try to stand up for her, inciting a fight with the guards once again, as one of the prisoners that we saw earlier whisked Marion away. Again, it's a little hard to describe the scene without giving too much away, so mm-hmm. encourage you guys to read the book.
Mm-hmm.
So cut back to Mr. Collins, and plot twist, he wasn't trying to get Marion back. He hated her so much that he expedited getting her off the planet. And his new wife, aka his former mistress, Mrs. Collins, got temporarily locked up because he fucked up so bad. Reunited with his new wife, the manager tells the couple that as a courtesy, they won't have to worry about Marion ever again.
My jaw dropped to the goddamn floor. I was like, the audacity of this.
I did not see this twist coming when I first read this issue, so I think it really works here.
Mm-hmm.
Again, back on Bitch Planet, cornered by guards, the other prisoner defends Marion with martial arts, but it's not enough as a mysterious figure is able to slit Marion's throat and disappear from the scene. We learn the woman defending Marion is mispronounce this here, Kamau Kogo. Mm-hmm. And the two observers who have been in this book, but they're not really that important, remark that they just found the star of their show. And that's the end of issue one.
Wow, he breezed by that quick. Okay. This is why you take notes, people, but I don't.
Yeah, look how the length of this for Mikey's sections versus mine. They're going to be at least double.
This issue was a very, very great start. Very, very bold in your face. Like, I just feel like, this is what the book is, people. Deal with it. Like, it's I love that attitude that Kelly Sue DeConnick brings to the table with the series. Overall, I do like how it's very kind of like a very like dystopian, like totalitarian type of vibe that we get throughout the world of Bitch Planet. How, you know, how the people on the ground, you know, how they think about, you know, the people that are deemed as, you know, I don't know if you mentioned it, but they're deemed as non-compliance and NCs. I think it's very interesting. And, this was dope. It was such a cool start. You'll probably have more to say, but.
I think this is a great first issue. I mean, a lot of first issues admittedly kind of suck, and this one really captures your attention. So I think it succeeds there. Like I said, the plot twist in this with the husband is great. It's again, it's something you kind of have to read for yourself to fully get. Like I said in the very beginning, you get that it's a dystopia right away. There's literally like obey signs and you should have like an eating disorder basically signs in the background. That like this isn't a good place to be.
But yeah, no, it's very interesting. The hologram, this hologram that is designed to pretty much kind of manipulate them and control them in a way due to like, you know, the various, you know, imagery that you always see the hologram in at various times.
The hologram's like, it's a little probably more than a little dominatrixy, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
But it's like, it's like weird because as we'll see in this book, like, they're kind of puritanical in some ways, but they also use that sexy imagery. So it is, I guess, like you said, very exploitation-y.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which I mean is the vibe of the whole style of the book. Like this, like when I first read this issue, it really felt like, yeah, no, like I could, if they did this, if they could afford to do this movie back in like the 70s, I could definitely see it working for sure.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, nah. It's overall, it's good. It's really good. It's really good start. What are your thoughts on Valentino's art? I love his art. I think it's very, it reminds me a lot of people familiar like David Aja, who did like the Hawkeye run, like the only good Hawkeye run that exists.
Oh, yeah, I can see that. I like the art in this book. I think it fits for what they're going for.
Mm-hmm. Very bold lines, very kind of like in a way like a mash between like realism and comic book style. It's really well done, and he, whoever's coloring the book too really adds that, you know, that exploitation grindhouse look that makes it all come together. I really like it a lot. But yeah, this is great. This is great. But I also want to say real quick before we move on, Penelope. I immediately I fell in love with her the moment that we saw her uppercut that guard in the face. she's great. But
we'll talk about her later because she gets her own issue in this volume, but she's a great character.
Real quick, shout out to Mr. Brooks. I can see the comments. I'm not ignoring you. It's a lot going on. But shout out to Mr. Brooks. Shout out to Trey from Blurcoa. Thanks for joining us. Appreciate you. All right, so we move on to issue dos.
So Bitchplanet number 2. I really like the covers for this. I think this is one of the better covers in this first volume 2 with them fighting. I don't really have any more comments on the cover than that.
It's awesome. It reminds me of like again those exploitation posters, I was about to say Black Dynamite, but Black Dynamite also does count technically. Like Black Dynamite or like Dolomite or like for in terms of Women's History Month, shout out to like Coffee, Pam Grier. Look that up. People don't know Coffee from Pam Grier back in the 70s. Great film. So yeah, I it's good. It's a really good cover.
All right. So again, hopping into this issue, we start at a gala. As a man that we'll learn is called Father Josephson, gives a speech on the nature of humanity and us versus them and how this ties into this universe's version of the Hunger Games. So after he gives the speech, thank you, I try. After he gives his speech, Father Josephson tells his subordinate, Brandon, that engagement for the games is down. Brandon insists that the ratings are steady, and it's not his job to make people care, but Josephson retorts that his job is to do whatever they, the government, tell you to do. Cut to Bitch Planet, Kamau, or Cam, is stuck in an interrogation room with the hologram asking why she killed Marion, and guilting her over the fact that Marion had a son. And again, it's very like patriarchal. It's not about her killing another person. It's about her killing another person who had a relationship to a man, which is a very common theme in this book. As Cam refutes this and breaks the screens in the room, a real woman working at the prison walks in, calling herself Miss Whitney. Whitney changes the room to look like Southern Georgia and offers Cam a glass of sweet tea, which she refuses until Whitney insists that they don't need to slip something in her drink to drug her. Cam once again says that she didn't kill Marion, and Whitney says she's not here for a confession but rather with an opportunity. Cam used to be a professional athlete, and Whitney in the larger government as a whole wants her to form a women's prison team for their fight to the death. Cam refuses, disgusted at the thought of a of women getting their asses beat to fund the place that's imprisoning them, which very fair. And Whitney tries to use Cam's brother as leverage, but Cam says she has no brother as Whitney leaves her to be returned to General Pop. Later at the prison gym, the other prisoners tell Cam that she should build the team. Cam says that they have no chance of winning, but the other inmates think that if they play it right and pick the right people, they could maybe win. More importantly, one of the prisoners, Mako, mentions that if they can get a team on a government ship where the arena would be, if something were to happen, a lot of big government guys would go down. And she helped design that ship.
Yep, because coincidentally, she just designed the ship. Yeah. That's plot. I love it. No, but also, you just mind you, if you look at the paintings here during this entire conversation, Penelope's getting with another fight with a bunch of guards, and then like the girl that that she's talking to originally just jump away. Oh shit, she's getting jumped. Let me join in real quick. And just starts to join her, and the conversation's still going while she's on the treadmill. It is. I love this scene a lot. I love the way it's broken down in terms of the layout. I think it's awesome. It's such a fun scene.
Yeah, and again, it's very cinematic too. This feels like it could be the Oh my god, what's the word for it? The drawings, the storyboards.
The storyboards, yeah.
So later, Cam tells Whitney that she's agreed to put a team together, but she has a few conditions. They need to give Cam's assets to her family right away. She needs a list of everyone's names and weights, and she needs the name of Marion's real killer. And then finally, on Earth, Joseph is informed that a famous athlete has died during the games. Not Cam, this is just like some random guy. At least right now in the plot, as far as I know, he's not really relevant. But big athlete, so it's sad. But while he should be sad, he can't help but smile as he watches engagement rise through the roof, telling his assistant to give the bitch planet's prison director on the phone. And that's the end of the issue.
It's good.
Yeah. So it's coming really off good. That first issue, like I said, I only read the first issue like a year ago. And it's kind of a tone switch. I didn't expect it to go, like it keeps saying, Hunger Games-y. It really reminded me initially a lot of the latest Hunger Games movie, the story of Songbirds and Snakes or whatever, and how a lot of that plot revolves around we need people to watch our unethical games.
Yeah. Engagement. Like the fact that he's like, I don't care about how this man died, like how this random athlete died. I'm just the fact that, like, because he was such a well-known male athlete that engagement's going to plummet and we need engagement. So I thought that was very interesting take, you know?
I think more than that, it was like the tragedy. Like, I didn't really mention it, but they have the mom on TV crying and all these people, I guess, coming out to support him. And tragedy sells, I guess.
Honestly, in terms of media, it does. That's actually in real life. Too.
Again, it keeps tying back into the themes of exploitation in this. And again, everywhere in the book you look, when they're in the gym, you can see sexy girls stretching in the background and all that, you know?
Yeah, for sure. It comes full circle pretty much. But I do want to mention though, I want to go back because I thought this page was nuts. Just in terms of like this torture room that this like very like dominatrixy holograph woman is literally telling her, hey, yeah, how did it feel to kill this woman? Because she had a boy, she had a son. You took a son's mother away from her. How dare you being like that very patriarchal kind of like form of just like mental torture.
I said, it's not about another person dying. It's about what she did for a man that made her important.
Which is, again, that's messed up. But we know what you're trying to say, Sonya DeConnick. Yeah. We get it. And I love it.
This book is not subtle.
No, it really isn't. But yeah, overall, man, I do agree the tonal shift was a little bit unexpected. Because we both agreed, like, off camera that, like, while from issue one and then, like, the rest of the entire series, like, we did not expect it to go the route that it did, tonally and narratively. But, like, yeah, it still works very well. I do like, what's her name? Mallory is the name? Is the guard chief here?
Whitney.
Oh, Whitney, sorry. That she is, I don't know, I'm trying to figure out what Kelly's trying to say, but she's more of the
I think she's supposed to be like, I mean, she's a white woman, so it's yeah, supposed she's to be a white like woman, she's kind of sure. in a privileged position. Like, she thinks, I guess, that she's doing something for women by being here.
Yeah, yeah. Even though she's mostly focused, she's mostly, like, under a, like, patriarchal, like, dominant, like lens. But, like, she's saying, oh, but I'm doing this for the good of women, even though it's for a patriarchal agenda of, like, controlling non-compliant women. Not me.
Yeah, so. she's perpetuating the system that oppresses her, if you will.
yes. That way, yeah, I find her an interesting character. She's schemy. She's snaky. Obviously, she has her own agendas.
Again, this is not subtle. You know right off the bat that you shouldn't trust her.
Yeah, nah, not at all. I also do like our main character here. She's I feel like it's Kelly Sue DeConnick inserting her own personality onto like the character, because she's very abrupt. She has no time for bullshit. She does, like, you know, she's very blunt and bold about what she's trying to say at all times. But I do like the fact that she's just like, that's that quote you said where she's like, yeah, you didn't have to like, you know, put something in my drink or in a drug. You could have just fucking done it. Like, I thought that was so funny. And the fact that, like, yeah, like, she obviously isn't going to trust her at all. But at the same time, like, she's very against this team being formed for this sporting event. But I do how, like, you know, it takes all the other prisoners that have a bigger picture in terms of how to getting out of here to kind of sway her into actually making that choice to form this team and just giving it a try. You know?
Yeah, it's an underdog story. The odds are against them, but they still have that, like, just a little bit of hope that it could work out.
Exactly. And yeah, it works. Real quick, Trey is over here to have some comments saying patriarchy reinforcing norms about matriarchy. That is also a good point. And he said all through the male lens is pulpy. I really need to pick this up. Yes, you do, because it was really good. That's all I really gotta say though. This issue was good. I liked it a lot. So what would it move on to issue 3?
Yeah, issue 3. This might be my favorite issue of the volume because it's the only one that focuses on like a single character so far. And it's focusing on, I wouldn't call her a side character, but it's focusing on Penelope, who isn't the main character, you know?
Yeah, I also actually agree with you. I was going to say, actually, this is also my favorite. This is my favorite issue in the entire volume. I loved it. We'll get into why we loved it. But first off, this cover, love it as usual. Also, just being a graphic designer, like my graphic designer, but I love the use of the font here and how it's placed within the cover, make it look like a movie poster, an exploitation style, grindhouse style movie poster. I love it a lot.
I feel like usually we complain about there being a lot of text in covers, but I think it works here.
Yeah, it works here. Like, and it also gives you like what a movie poster should do. It's supposed to give you kind of like a preview of what to expect going into watching a film, you know? Obviously we don't do this style anymore because, you know, we're more of a more of an image focus more than actual text now in this area of, like, you know, poster design. But from what it's trying to do, the style it's trying to invoke, it works so well. And I love it.
All right.
Yep.
So getting into it, we begin with Penelope standing in front of a virtual council as repulsively they read off her offenses, which include insubordination, assault, being ugly, and of course, being fat. The council tells her that she should be grateful she's here and that they just want to help her. This triggers a flashback to a young Penelope making cupcakes with her grandma. She accidentally gets batter in her hair and everywhere, and the two start a lighthearted food fight. Suddenly, the grandma's dog starts barking, and she tells Penelope to run as she opens the door to a bunch of armed men coming at them. We learn that at age 8, Penelope was adopted by the state, and that her mother also had issues that landed her on a similar path to where Penelope is right now. So then we get another flashback to her time in the state home. She punched a boy and got sent to whatever the orphanage's equivalent to a principal's office is. Penelope explains that the boy was talking about her grandma who had recently been arrested. The home runner tells her that her loyalty is admirable, but blind loyalty is the act of the fool. Before brushing Penelope's uncooperative hair, I have that written in quotes. Penelope mm-hmm. asks why it can't be enough to just know who she is, and the lady tells her that she needs to see things through the father's eyes, and that she'll teach her even if it kills them both, pulling out a hair straightener. So again, a lot of themes of conformity here.
Yes. Can I say something real quick? I have to say this now.
Yeah, go for it.
I thought this scene was... I thought this was a great scene, just not just because of obviously what, in terms of, you know, trying to get Penelope to conform into this more patriarchal society, which is the standard of living in this world, but also what kind of was meta, because you have a white blonde lady who has straight hair, literally while giving her this spiel is trying to take Penelope's natural nappy hair and obviously like natural black nappy hair and getting a straightener because this is deemed unprofessional or uncontempt, which is again as a black person, as black people, that is what that's a microaggression that we face all the time, just simply how our hair is supposed to look.
And I'm and I would call that, I don't know if I'd call that subtle, but I think that is one of those things, like, if you were a white person and you weren't aware of that, that's something that would probably go over your head in this scene, but it's a nice, mm-hmm. like, layer of subtext here.
Good subtext, yeah. Very good. And I love it. But, alright. Continue.
Alright, so in the present, Penelope gets hooked up to a bunch of electrical nodes. According to the council, they're using some kind of algorithms and sci-fi bullshit to be able to see Penelope's ideal self, and this will help them be able to build a plan for her treatment and make her presumably into someone who's like skinny and just wants to listen to a man and all that kind of stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So we get yet another flashback. This time Penelope's working in a bakery. Some asshole comes in demanding service shortly after just opening and threatening to report her to her husband, to which she responds that she doesn't have one. She's state-sponsored. Meanwhile, on the TV, the news talks about the latest trends in diet parasites, and three women split a single muffin between the three of them, counting the calories in it. This angers Penelope, which is not helped by the fact that the asshole starts talking about who'd ever want to marry such a big woman, and is also just straight-up racist. Like, it's very uncomfortable to read, honestly.
Yeah, I didn't like reading it either.
Eventually, all the noise just gets to be too much, and Penelope breaks the screens, beats the guy up, and chases the skinny girls off.
Good.
It's a great scene, though. Mm-hmm. You can really feel the buildup in it as it's happening.
Mm-hmm.
But back to reality, the council turns on the idealization machine and gasps in horror as Penelope laughs. Her ideal version of herself is who she already is. And as she says, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. I ain't broke and you bastards ain't ever gonna break me. And that's the end of the issue. It's very simple, but it's super effective. I love the ending. I love the message of that, and not like wanting to change yourself and not seeing yourself as something that needs to be changed. I just think it's a great issue.
When I saw that ending of just her laughing in the mirror, seeing herself and all these men just gasp because why doesn't she conform to what we want? I was like, after reading that issue, I just like put my phone out. I just clapped. I was like, yes.
Because it's something, because they establish her personality early. You see it coming, but it's still like very satisfying when you get to that ending.
Exactly. And I thought that was such a powerful moment to be like, yeah, no, like, why would she, like, she's so proud of who he is and like, you know, and doesn't need, she doesn't want to conform to what everyone else seems to visions as ideal. And I thought that was so great, and it's very like, has like, it's good subtext, you know, there's body positivity in there, there's, you know, very like, you know, very like self, like very confident self-identity put in there, like, it's good stuff in this issue. Yeah. Man, you're right, it's very simple, but in terms of like the plot, but you know, I thought, you know, simple, like a little less hurt, a little less was more in this.
Again, to go back to what we said earlier, it's very unapologetic, especially this issue, and I think that's what makes it work so well.
Mm-hmm. This is my favorite issue, and like that's what I was like. I knew I liked Penelope from the beginning, but then like after reading this, I was like, I love her. She's great. She's such a great character. Well, great side character. I really like this a lot. I thought it was good stuff. Any more thoughts on the issue?
That's all I got. Like I said, it's simple, but it's a good read.
Yeah, for sure. Also, we have a comment. And it said, like, the Black Spider says, I've never read this book. I'm like, listen, hey, I mean, I will put a link at the end of the stream so you can find a place to buy the book. But yeah, no, at least you're here to help us listen to us talk about it. And that they like story time, which is good. We're happy to provide a story time for you. but anyway, moving on to issue number 4. So thoughts on the cover, Rebecca?
I like it. I like the, you know, raised fist. Again, it feels very 70s, as all of these do. There's almost not that much to say about them because they are very much the same style, but they're all kind of great.
Mm-hmm. No, again, I really like this a lot. This is actually this image over here is the image for the thumbnail. So I really like it a lot. Very, very grimy. Like, very just grimy and just like tough and just like, let's go. I think it's really well done. But yeah, so we'll just get into it. So this issue starts off with Josephson and I forget the guy's name. Rolandez, I think that's what his name is. The guy who was talking with the husband in the beginning, who was in charge of Bitch Planet. Yeah, so they're talking at the athlete's funeral, and pretty much just the gist of it is that, hey, we kind of like this idea. We're going with using this, we're using Bitch Planet to, you know, be the next step in our games because, you know, we love engagement here in patriarchy. So hey, we're gonna give you all the money that you need so that you can fund this operation. And also while they're doing this, because they're talking during the funeral, and at the same time he's just like, yeah, let's just like get the fuck out of here. This really isn't that important. It's just like, damn. So it cuts right into also, I don't know if you mentioned those two guys, those not, they're not guards, but like they watch the cameras and everything.
Yeah, they're like observers for the prison, but they don't, at least again, yeah, they haven't really been relevant outside of making like commentary.
Exactly. But yeah, so we move on to God, why am I blanking? I know this girl's name. It starts with a K.
I just say Kim because I don't think I'm pronouncing her full name right.
it starts off with Cam, and she's pretty much like going through all of the various dossiers and photos of members of Bitch Planet. She's going to assemble her team. And at the same time, we get one of the other characters, one of the other prisoners, bringing in lunch, and she pretty much gives her, actually not lunch, she's giving her a reading. She's giving them books to read. And she pretty much talks about how, like, there is, she may have a way to kind of like make things move along like a lot quicker, and maybe have a potential chance to get out of here. So she gives her a little note, and that's pretty much it. And to go to the showers, I believe. It cuts to the next scene where it's called the obligatory shower scene, and the scary dominatrix hologram lady is basically like going, is talking pretty much about getting all these women in the shower, stuff like that. And just know, I can't show everything in the rest of this in this issue after this. I think I only got this page, and then like the rest I really can't. But it's pretty much telling them to have a good morning. But like, hey, like, you have to take care of yourself. Your body is a temple, but you have to be perfect. And you know, more of that like, you know, perfect messaging. And then we get introduced to this one character. I'm gonna call her Crazy Eyes just because this is reminding me a lot of Orange Is New Black, and she reminds me of Crazy Eyes. So I'm calling her Crazy Eyes. So this, pretty much, this is the person that the prisoner in the last scene wanted her to meet, and she's pretty much escorted to an area of the showers where where all the cameras are pretty much out of sight, and also the guards can't really enter due to like, you know, privacy. And at the same time, she kind of reveals that don't know how to say this because it's just so weird. But it's just she had her and the previous and the prisoner in the last scene. They're kind of in a not relationship, but kind of more of like a very
No, I think you can say they're in a relationship.
Yeah, sure. I was thinking like situationship, but they pretty much
might be better actually.
Yeah, they're in a situationship. And they're pretty much, you know, they're doing their thing with the guards, doing their thing in the shower. However, the catch is that even though they're away from all the cameras and the guards, they get one provision to keep all the other guards away by having this one guard, who they call Tommy Peepers, to have a little bit of a look-see of what they're doing, as a deal they negotiate. And you see this, his eyes and like the little peephole. It's so creepy and it's so weird. but yeah. So it transitions to a presentation about the Dua Mila, which is the sporting event that I'm talking about. It's pretty much just now two of these Valley Girl holograms basically just explaining like the rules and whatnot. And I'm not really gonna go into it because, not gonna lie, I tried reading these rules multiple times and the ADHD wasn't keeping up. I could not get what was happening. I don't know, Rebecca, do you
have a gist? Yeah, they explained it, but it's still, I guess it's kind of like football where you got to get to like an end zone and you tackle and fight each other along the way, but it's not quite clear exactly what's going on there.
Yeah.
It doesn't really matter anyway.
It doesn't matter at all. But pretty much, Whitney and Cam are pretty much at the center of the field. They pretty much are talking about all of the people that they recruited and you know, just pretty much just having the play, and they're going to pretty much just train for a second. It's a really interesting scene. But I have the rules of the game. I'm not going to read them because it's too convoluted and too big. But yeah, it's just football. It's football, dodgeball, like, I don't know, it's something. But so pretty much she goes through all the dossiers one more time, and there is someone that is not listed that is a part of the dossier, but I don't really think it actually matters. But Whitney says that there's a glitch in the system involving that inmate. But who we have here, we have, you know, Penelope, we have Mako, and we have some other prisoners that are recruited as well. So they're pretty much going through the training, and they pretty much have a plan to have Penelope just be just the brick wall as just like the only ounce of defense they have, while Mako, who is the quick one, pretty much is gonna be taking the ball all the way to the end of the field. So after practice goes well and they have a plan, basically they're celebrating in the showers, being like, oh yeah, they might have a chance to win this thing, and you know, it's just hyping people up. So while everyone else, you know, is distracted, she ends up going to the peeping Tom corner, you know, where there aren't any guards because of that deal that was made. She ends up, you know, going over there and turning on the shower and proceeds to give Tommy Peepers a show and starts, you know, pleasuring herself and all that stuff. And he's just going crazy to the point where he's just like, she hears a peep and he's like, got you. And then goes to his people to like, when he rips off the shower, breaks the wall down, and then ends up ripping peeping Tom out. And then he pretty much explains that, like, you know, yeah, I know who you are, and I know your name, I know what's going on. And also I want to point out that, like, you know, remember, you know, the fathers who you work for, they're all about perfections, right? You have three distinct birth dimples on your penis, and they will not like that. So if you want me to rat, you gotta listen to me, and because, you know, we're gonna make a deal, and you're gonna help me find my sister. And it ends with them in the showers and him just threatening, and it's great. And that's all this issue is. That's on issue three. Issue four, sorry.
Oh yeah, this is a fun issue. Again, don't really quite get the sport they're describing, but it doesn't really matter anyway. At least not at this point. I think the action with the peeping Tom at the end is really cool. Again, very, it feels like something that would happen in the 70s or 80s, like, action movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I like, too, in this last panel, the, like, reverse imagery here with, like, her holding the pipe and all that, you know?
Yeah, it's awesome. It's very, very good imagery there. I mean, yeah, no, I thought this issue was good. It was fun. Actually, like, you know, seeing now the plan is underway with, you know, the actual, the team is now assembled. They're going to start training. And, you know, maybe they actually may have a chance of winning with going with their, really, like, simple strategy of having Penelope just be the only defense because she's a big girl, and having Michael being so quick to just, you know, go to the end of the field.
You need is one tank and one sprinter.
Exactly. So yeah, we play team-based games. You know how it is. That's usually the game plan, regardless. But I thought that was very interesting. But yeah, no, the fact that, like, you know, we get also like a dynamic of, like, you know, how prison shower dynamics work.
They say in this that even when there's no cameras, everyone's always watching.
Everyone's always watching you. So that if I didn't make that deal with Peeping Tom, again, creepy as hell. But like, it's the fact that they have that deal with him is just strange. The fact that, you know, and it's great that, like, Cam exploits that deal to her advantage, because again, to reveal that she doesn't have a brother like Whitney said that she did, but she has a sister that she's looking for.
Well, I think the implication in this is that her sister is trans, but we haven't seen her sister, so we don't actually know that.
Yeah,
that's how I interpreted it anyway.
Yeah, I actually didn't interpret it that way. I just thought, like, that she just should have had a sister that either is in Bitch Planet somewhere, or maybe somewhere on Earth that, you know, maybe she has a reason why she can't get to her. So
yeah, I guess we'll have to continue reading to find out.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, because we won't figure that out next issue at all. I'm good. This issue I thought was pretty solid. But yeah, we'll just move on to issue number 5. So issue 5 of Bitch Planet. Thoughts on the cover, Rebecca? Thoughts on the cover?
I like it. I like the like splattered paint look on it to be like the stars here.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the colors. That's all I got.
Yeah, it's pretty simple. It's one of the most simpler covers out of them all, but it's very, again, very beautiful in terms of the color palette and also the text they use. But steal yourselves for heartbreak. Which work in progress? Which WIP will RIP? Classic exploitation poster shit. I love it a lot. But yeah, just to start off, it starts off with a news reporting. The gist of it's pretty much it just talking about how, you know, they're gonna start doing the Duamila with the prisoners from Bitch Planet, the fact that they're all, you know, it's an all-female team, and the public I have a mixed reaction to it, but obviously because it's entertainment, it's more so positive than mostly negative. So,
well, I think they're saying here too that they might be forced to watch it.
Yeah, because again, crap. Word starts with an E. We literally were just saying it a bunch of times. exposure. Exposure.
Engagement. That's it.
Yeah, engagement. Yeah, the other E word, engagement, because again, engagement is important. But yeah, so it pretty much starts off with Josephson originally on the phone with his wife, and just the way he talks to his wife is just gross. I don't want to even repeat it just because it's weird. But that's not really important. But we get a introduction to the character of Makoto, and Makoto pretty much is, I assumed he was like an architect. Yeah, he's pretty much like an architect that like designs, that he was the original designer for Bitch Planet. And Josephson pretty much has a task for him to complete with this era of the Duamila. So you get the title card and transitions to now all the girls preparing to preparing for their first, it's not a real match. I wasn't sure if you got this. I don't know if it was a real match or if this was like a practice match.
Yeah, because
the guards are involved. And they explain all the rules. And at the same time, and I love how Valandro illustrates this and how Kelly Sue DeConnick paces it. But while this is happening, we get kind of like these brief introductions to various other prisoners that we weren't really introduced to that are part of this team. And we get like dossiers and all that, and we get a lot of like instances of like of their crimes, of how they got into to Bitch Planet, and the more you read them, the more ridiculous it is compared to like what they actually got in for, and it's just like, oh god, hate this world, hate the fathers, but yeah, so pretty much transitions to Makoto, or aka Mac, who he would like to be called as, pretty much. Again, talking about how like Jobson is like, yeah, you're the best at what you do. We really want you to build this arena for the Duomila. And the crutch is that he wants him to build it in a very small, limited amount of time. And Mac does say that it addressed it. It's not really that feasible, you know. But he's not listening because again, he wants a brief time window and he wants that engagement, Rebecca. He wants that sweet, sweet engagement. But here's a crutch though. He says, hey, listen, if you do this, you'll not only be able to, you know, build a really dope event that will be memorized in the father's hearts, but also the fact that you're able to see her, and they don't say who her is. Transitions to now the girls and the guards preparing for the game. They go over the rules and all that stuff, and they're pretty much just getting ready to go. They're stretching, they're prepping. And they're gonna go with the plan again. That again, all of the blunt hits were gonna go, and the defense is gonna Penelope while Mako sneaks past and rushes with the ball towards the end zone. Transitions to Mac and I believe it is Josephson's assistant, but he pretty much has a conversation with him. He's kind of like skeptical about maybe pursuing this. And he's saying that, and the assistant's saying that he's probably definitely afraid for sure. And he wants to let you know, yeah, like even going on Bitch Planet and constructing this arena, it's not really gonna be, some people view it as kind of like an off-world vacation site, but in reality, it's not the case. And it's gonna be more expensive than what folks are willing to recognize. But yeah, it's just, He's pretty much giving Mac various apprehensions on doing this, and that, you know, the council might have the wrong idea of making this action like come together, and he's like, you know what I'm saying? He's like, yeah, I do, and yeah, so giving Mac some doubts. Transitions again, and as you can see here, Rebecca, the games are going, but. It may look like, you know, the guards aren't really playing that fair. I don't know about you, but
who would have thought?
Yeah, who would have thought that the authoritarians were gonna play fair? But yeah, they're like fouls are happening and they're not being called, and the guards are hitting players in spots they shouldn't be hitting. And they're doing some illegal stuff, and it's pissing Penelope off. So it transitions to Mac on his way home, talking to his wife, and pretty much his wife is begging him not to do this because she knows why he isn't doing this to appease the father. He's doing this so he can see her and to see who her is, and we pretty much get the reveal that, you know, her is their daughter. And again, his wife is very apprehensive because she does not. She wants Mac to let things go and to move on. But obviously, he clearly doesn't want to because he wants to see his daughter again. And it cuts to his daughter. And we see a little bit of a photo of what his daughter looks like. But then I don't have this page here. But it transitions to again the next game, and his daughter is revealed to be Maiko. Who is again our offensive player who is going to be taking most of the goals, and so it transitions again, and again a lot of the guards are not playing fair. They're cheating. Their fouls are not being called. They're more so injuring more of the players than anything. Even though again Penelope is also beating the shit out of them all. So there's that. And while this is happening, Michael conducts the plan again. Penelope's taking most of the hits, and well, the other players, while she rushes towards the end goal with the ball, And while she does, she starts to gloat for a quick second and shows off, hey, I got the ball. Look at me, we're about to win. But yet a guard decides to come up behind her, drag her by the hair, and pretty much slam her onto the ground. And again, that is a foul, but it pretty much, but Whitney refers to it, calls it as a point one for the guards. And then clearly Michael is badly hurt, and isn't really moving. And then all like Penelope, Cam, and the other girls rush to her aid, and pretty much Whitney wants to. Whitney gives them all pain, like, yeah, if you rush her to the medical bay, it also technically counts as a forfeit. But then it is revealed that, you know, like, Lizzie, like, how can we help? He's like, Lizzie, who's the other prisoner? He's like, how can we help? And Cam's like, how can we help? And then Lizzie's saying, yeah, we can't really do anything. Her neck is broken, and she's dead, Cam. She killed Michael. And that's how this issue ends. So thoughts on issue number 5 of that book?
This is kind of a crazy cliffhanger for volume 1. Mm-hmm. It does feel very much less like a satisfying end to volume 1 and more just like a halfway point in the book, which is what this is.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it's a good issue. Again, I think the buildup of them playing the game and the guards getting increasingly aggressive and unfair, and also Whitney just evilly smiling as they're doing so.
Exactly.
Is good. I like how with Makoto Mac, you can tell that he's not really, that there's something up with him that he's not saying. And if you recall earlier in issue 2, Mako said that she built the ship, but in this, her dad's giving credit for it. So things aren't quite lining up either, you know?
Exactly. Yeah, I'm assuming it might be something schemey business-wise. I think because you saw how apprehensive his wife was about going to see her. So I'm assuming maybe Michael actually did build the ship, but maybe her dad took the credit for it because, you know, he's a man. I don't know. It could be any reason, but yeah, I do think that it's an interesting angle to take where Mac is very hesitant to maybe go see his daughter, but is building this arena on Bitch Planet to go eventually to see his daughter. But now knowing how the issue ends, that he's going to see a daughter that he's never going to see ever again because she's killed by the guards here. And it's very messed up and just sad.
But it also completely destroys their set strategy for winning the game.
Exactly. So now I gotta change it up a little bit. Overall, this issue was, I thought this issue was pretty good. Again, that cliffhanger ending was just damn. And I didn't really see it coming.
I didn't see it coming either.
Yeah. But this issue was really good. And also Joseph's and a lot more Joseph in here. Again, scheming just so that, you know, he can get that nice, sweet engagement that he wants. I think it's very, very interesting.
Yeah, I do think one criticism I have, I think they give the girls dossiers in this, and I don't know if there'll be more in the next 5 issues, but I feel like I don't know any of the characters that well.
Yeah.
Penelope.
I agree too. Yeah, like that's kind of the crux with them. With this is like with this volume so far is that you obviously want to focus on Cam because she's the main character, but I feel like they should have spent a little bit more time to maybe like give us not to flesh them out completely, but like make us care about these smaller characters that are going to be a part of this team going forward, you know?
I think the pacing's good. You just need a little more depth there, I think.
Exactly. Exactly what I agree with. But overall, I thought this issue was good. But yeah, that is the only gripe I have, is I have pretty much the same deal, that a little more depth with the other characters to make us care about them more going forward. But Rebecca, do you want to just go give our final thoughts and our final verdict, unless you have anything else you want to say?
Yeah, I'm good for final thoughts.
All right. So final thoughts, people, on Bitch Planet Volume 1. Rebecca, I'll let you go first. It's Women's History Month, so I'll go last.
All right. Yeah, I really like this book. Again, this is only the first volume. It's 10 issues total, so this is the first 5. it feels like a halfway point, but because of that, because mm-hmm. it's not a satisfying end, I do want to read and finish the rest of the issues. So far, it's short and, again, relatively simple, pretty easy to breeze through. And yeah, it's just a fun read.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, overall for me, this volume one was, I really enjoyed it. Again, very unapologetic, very in your face, very not afraid to talk about what it wants to talk about in terms of the commentary here, especially the feminist commentary here. The style of it, DeLandro's artwork, I think is very well done in terms of the style that's going for, the colors. I don't know who the colorist is. I don't have him credited on here. I believe it is crap. Because the colors are amazing in this book. Chris Peter. Chris Peter and the colors, again, amazing. I really enjoy the color palette for this series a lot. And a lot of the main characters, the Cam, I think, is very interesting. Penelope is my favorite character. I love her. And I love her her dedicated issue a lot. It's the best issue, I think, in the whole volume. The world, the very totalitarian, patriarchal dystopian state that they live in, I think is very interesting and complex in terms of, like, you know, the whole non-compliance message of the whole thing. I really do like this book a lot, and it just makes me want to just get Kelly Sue DeConnick on the show more, because we got an interview on this, because this book is incredible. Yeah. I really do.
Maybe
like
one day. We tried in the past and they were always too busy.
Yeah, what? Fairly, because yeah, her and her also her husband, who is people know she's married to Matt Fraction, who's one of my top five favorite writers of all time. He's also doing great things in comics, so it makes sense why they would be busy. But maybe we'll get them on the show. Hopefully, yeah, guys, yeah, bomb them to social media. Tell them to get on the show. Trey has a comment here. It says, it's built a big world and focus on a tiny bit of it. Give us the mission, overthrow, liberate. I like that.
Yeah, me too.
That's good shit. Rebecca, what would you give Bitch Planet out of 10? Well, volume 1 out of 10.
Volume 1, I would give a 7. I think that rating is going to go up if it hits the landing on this. I think that's going to go up.
Oh yeah, for sure. I would give it, I think, a 7.5. I think that's the only thing about it, is that it does feel like, you know, like the rest of the story is still yet to be told. So that's why I'm like giving it a 7.5. I would give it an 8 if, you know, it felt like a complete, like, volume, you know what I mean? But obviously it's literally like a half of a story. So
yeah, it's a good foundation.
It's a good foundation. That's actually the best way to put it. This book is awesome. And just for people that I want to add real quick, her letters page, I think, was so interesting, because obviously her letters page is titled Bitch Fest. I think it's like awesome. Like, it's so funny. I wanted to point out that, like, yeah, like, because this book this came out like around, I think, like 2016, I believe. I could be wrong, but this book actually has like a big audience, and it actually spoke to a lot of people that resonated with the book. And I was telling Rebecca off camera, and you see the letters pages, but it was to the point where people love this book so much that a lot of people, like women, people in the LGBTQIA+ community, a lot of them got the non-compliance symbol tattooed on their bodies, which, again, like, is crazy. Like, they kind of thought that it was very crazy to be like how much impact this had on that demographic, on the comic book, on the comics, and comics fans. I think is very telling how good this book is, you know. So I thought that was a nice little note to add. So it was really cool, fun fact. But and that's pretty much it, Rebecca. I mean, I got another thoughts to say. I'm gonna put a link down below to where you can buy the volumes for the volumes of for Bitch Planet. Just note, yeah, there's Bitch Planet Volume 1, then Volume 2, and then there was a sequel mini series called Bitch Planet Triple Feature. I think that's what it's called. There's plenty of Bitch Planet to go around. Definitely recommend check out this book. I think this book, even though it's a 7.5 for me, this gets the Indie Corner stamp of approval. Like, it's a must read, I think. I feel like in indie comics, especially comics with this feminist point of view, I think it's very well done. But yeah, people, so that's pretty much it. So thanks everybody who are watching this or will watch this. We appreciate the support. Feel free to comment, like, subscribe. Let us know if you have read Bitch Planet, what are your thoughts on the book. Will you be checking out Bitch Planet? Let us know down in the comments who's your favorite character and why is it Penelope, because it has to be Penelope.
It's really the only choice at this point in the book.
Yeah. But yeah, feel free to give the notification bell so you know when we drop new content. Literally today, this morning, I just dropped our late review for late reaction to X-Men 97, because we planned it originally to come out weeks ago, but it just didn't work out. So in celebration of the show coming out, and we will do a review for the show eventually, hopefully in the future.
Hopefully before the show ends.
Yeah, hopefully before the show ends. We have that, since if you give our early thoughts on the show before it dropped. But yeah, check out the reactions, check out the highlights, check out our Indie Corner After Dark. Shout out to some of the people that are from the Lorcoa, because we did one with our Earning the Blur Without Fear, which was awesome and a lot of fun. Check out our recent gaming video that we did, Indie Corner Plays video, where Rebecca is playing Resident Evil 2, and that was a lot of fun, and I hope Rebecca continues it. Because
yeah, I want to do another one. I just don't know when I'm going to have time to do it.
I gotcha. Check out Transformers. Check out Deadly Class, which I am going to announce it now because we talked about it off screen, that it is coming back the start of April. So be on lookout for that, because I'm really excited to finish it up, because it apparently it's going to get crazier from here. So but yeah, as always, people, thank y'all. Appreciate the support. We love y'all. It means a lot to that fact that people are watching our stuff, and you know, we're growing slowly but surely. And we will have some more content hopefully planned in the near future, because I'm just excited. There's some stuff coming that I'm excited to talk about that I'm not gonna say yet, but yeah, as always, get home safe, and we'll catch y'all next time. All right, peace.